Hello, everyone. Welcome to the TEDx Cape Town Intersections of Change digital program, where today we are embarking on a journey towards gender equality and a decade of women. My name is Alex. I'm the events management lead here at TEDx Cape Town, and I am welcoming you from Bellville, Cape Town, South Africa. Please let us know where you're calling in the chat bar on the right-hand side. I see so many of us are from Cape Town. Hi there, fellow locals. And I see some people have called in from the US. Some people have called in from Italy. It's so amazing to have you here with us. Thank you so much. We are just about to launch a poll that you will find at the bottom of your screen. It is asking if this is your first TEDx Cape Town event. Please let us know. You can vote on whether this is your first event or not. If it is, welcome. Thank you so much for joining us. And if you are a regular or part of the TEDx Cape Town family, welcome back and thank you for joining us again. So a little bit of context about the Intersections of Change digital program. This gives us here at TEDx Cape Town an opportunity to reconnect with our past speakers, find out how they're doing, find out how they've adapted to COVID-19 and their ideas and initiatives have evolved since their past talk, and simply to check in. It is a 10-part digital series where we have already had 3 conversations, and if you've missed those, please find them on our YouTube channel. And we have 6 more scheduled for the rest of the year. If you haven't already, please go to our website and please subscribe to our newsletter where we will give you all the information that you need to attend these conversations. A very special mention and thanks to our sponsors, because without them and their contribution, this would not have been made possible. A huge thank you to the United States Consulate General, Cape Town, South Africa, to Missing Link, who is our tech team working on this production in the background, to Payfast, to Black Wolf Media for much of the collateral that you are seeing on our platforms, to Sird Fruit, and to all of our sponsors. Thank you so much. Right, so a decade of women. This is a call to action style event where we are exploring the possibility of reaching gender equality in the next 10 years. We are so honored and so fortunate to have 4 absolutely powerful and incredible gender activists in their own rights join us today on this conversation. Specifically, Dr. Marlene Wasserman, otherwise known as Dr. Eve, Shimmy Isaacs, Dr. Sindiwe Magona, and Mosidi Modise. And the main aim of this conversation is to appeal to you as an audience in your individual capacities and in your societies to catalyze change and to apply pressure to the current status quo so that we might be able to get gender equality by 2030. I'd like to give a very special introduction to Mosidi Modise. Mosidi Modise will be moderating this conversation, and in fact, this is the first time that we are featuring an external moderator on this digital program. Mosidi Modise is the Managing Director of Pivot Ventures and alumni member of the World Economic Forum Global Shapers Community. Mosidi has recently co-authored a report titled Shaping the Future of Work, which provides meaningful data and insights about the future of work young people want to see. She is an inspiring femtech entrepreneur who is currently building a tech-enabled venture that aims to close the gender wealth gap in a meaningful and sustainable way over the long term. Welcome, Mosidi. Welcome, welcome. Thank you so much for joining us. Welcome to the show.
Hi, Alex. Thank you so much for that warm welcome, and welcome everybody. And thank you so much for giving your time and joining us this evening for a discussion that I'm really amped and excited about. Firstly, because of the, you know, caliber and the quality of the panelists that we have. And secondly, about the fact that, you know, we are all called to do something with our lives. And for me, I feel very kind of empowered or enchanted about this notion of emancipating women. So yeah, I'm really, really excited for this evening.
Absolutely. I speak on behalf of the whole TEDx Cape Town team. We are so excited for this conversation. It has been a long time coming. And in fact, I think if I might be as bold as to say, this might be the most important conversation that we have hosted on intersections of change. I'm going to be hopping off and supporting you from the wings, but thank you so, so much for joining us, Mosidi. Thank you to each and every one of you here in our audience for joining us. Please share this conversation with your circles. It doesn't matter if they don't join right now, if they're able to, we will put this on our YouTube page, and it will also live here on Crowdcast. It's such an important conversation. Thank you so much, Mosidi. That's it from me.
Fantastic. Bye-bye. Thank you so much, Alex. You know, I couldn't agree more with Alex around the importance of this notion of how do we go about attaining gender equality within this decade, so by 2030. I mean, last year I had the opportunity to meet and engage with the Deputy Secretary General of the UN, Amina Mohammed. And what she shared with us is how the SDGs are interrelated, and that eradicating poverty cannot be achieved irreversibly without achieving gender equality. So gender equality is SDG number 5 of 17 that the UN had set out. And it cites that attaining gender equality is not only a fundamental human right, but a necessary foundation for a peaceful and prosperous, sustainable world. So without further ado, I have the great privilege of moderating this panel of incredible women this evening, who through their works are true advocates of women's rights. So we will be spending the next hour or so chatting with them individually as well as collectively. You are more than welcome and are free to pose as many questions as you would like to each of the respective speakers. So I'm going to bring up onto our virtual stage Dr. Sindiwe Magona. So first up is Dr. Sindiwe. Dr. Sindiwe is an award-winning author, storyteller, speaker, actor, teacher, and translator who has shared her inspiring talk, Poverty is Not Invincible, on the TEDx platform stage in 2016. If you haven't watched that TED talk, I highly encourage you to participate and go after this to go and watch it. It is incredible. She's a well-accomplished writer, having written over 150 children's books, 4 stage plays, 2 books of short stories, including Living, Loving, and Lying Awake, which was one of the Africa's top best 100 books for the 20th century. She has an autobiography and a biography out, and has written 4 novels, radio plays, and a screenplay. I'm just going to give it a few minutes to wait for Dr. Magona, and then we'll go to shoot away with some questions to her. Dr. Magona? Welcome, Dr. Magona. Thank you so much.
Let me move the light for better visibility.
Okay. We can see perfectly. So, Dr. Magona, I'm just going to shoot right away for one question to you. So you gave that powerful TED talk titled Poverty is Not Invincible, which is a remarkable story of your life and how you actively went out of your way to change the narrative of it. You know, for me, you are the epitome of one of my best mentors in life, which is life will show you how extraordinary it is when you show it how extraordinary you are. So part of your life, you spent 20 years working at the UN, And, you know, they're of the belief that the SDGs are a plausible framework by which we can make a difference in this world, and that the key challenges are very much interlinked to solve for. But I like your theory more that you highlight in your TED talk, where you say, let us be the keys to open the doors for the people clawing themselves out of poverty. And you have done so particularly well for women in your life. So can you shed some light with the audience and some tangible examples in your life where you became a key that unlocked doors for women that were in need?
Well, thank you, thank you, thank you. I like that. Life will show you how extraordinary it is when you show it how extraordinary you are.
Correct.
There is the basis for change. Belief in yourself. You are your best champion. Nobody can do for you more than you can do for yourself. I was very lucky. I didn't think so then, you know, because often in life, great good fortune will come disguised as bad luck, misfortune. If you told me at 23 that my husband walking away from me and all those children would have been my greatest escape or the doorway out of poverty, I wouldn't have believed it. I was very angry. But having had the good fortune and just sheer good luck, I stumbled on the fact that nobody was going to help me out of that situation. I had to do something. And, you know, anything the whole world thinks of doing for women or for the world is not likely to succeed if it doesn't, you know, wake up something in the individual who is in that situation, unless you, who is in a position that you do not like, hate it enough to want to M-O-V-E, move. When you start, I'm not saying it's easy. When you start thinking that way, you will soon see, you know, little, you know, doors and windows and cracks. There is a lot of help in the world. But first, you have to look for the help, find the help. You know, this month or last month, I found 2 scholarships in the newspaper. But if you don't read the newspaper, or if you don't know somebody who does and then says, here, you won't find those. The doors are there. But people need to be aware that a lot of the people who really need that help don't have access to the information for a variety of reasons. I escaped poverty. It wasn't overnight. But if you start thinking, what is the alternative? Do the hard work. It's going to be hard work. But if you don't do it, what is the alternative? You will stay steeped or sinking deeper and deeper into poverty. Is that the life you want for yourself? Is that the life you want for your children? The answer most people would say no. They want out. Show up your hand. Look for information. Look for people who are, you know, I have, and I don't have a big, vast organization that I'm heading, no. But because I know people who may have, be running scholarship, or I, as I said just now, I find information and then I know somebody, I ask people, people know, I will help if I can by pointing you in the right direction. That's all I can do, and that's what I do. I mean, there's a child, a young person, 21, you know, last year, he lost a year of schooling because he couldn't go, into any university. He didn't have the money. The mother, who is a single parent, has this one child. Even with the one child, she couldn't afford. You know, that child is doing tech or whatever. I see. Whatever, you know, these subjects that I don't know anything about. Last year, when he, you know, in June, his grades, he took 4 courses. 90 something, and wow. 70, 74. And he was angry at the 70. This is June test. December, it was all above 75 distinctions. He said, I'm not a first class person, I'm a distinction person. He wouldn't be there. He wouldn't be there if I hadn't linked him to a scholarship.
Sure.
Even out of my pocket. I don't have a deep pocket. I'm no Bill Gates, but I have access to information. I find, I research, and I steer people in the right direction.
Fantastic.
There are people who are doctors, there are people who are nurses, teachers, social workers, because I opened a door somewhere. It doesn't, no skin off my nose, nothing out of my pocket. I may help the pastor when they are going to apply, but by and large, really, it is just linking need with available resource.
Fantastic. Thank you so much. And you know, let's fast forward to 2020. We are now sitting in, you know, a global pandemic where many more people are in dire need. I mean, I was chatting to somebody earlier on who's a psychologist, and she was telling me of how the rate of like suicide has just gone up within the Cape Town area, you know, to her knowledge. But what's scary about this COVID pandemic is the other shadow pandemics is unfolding. And these underlying issues seem to be affecting women, I think, more gravely as, you know, breadwinners primarily in our society. And also it shows the lack of independence for women on many levels. So in your view, what has been the key challenges that are emerging as you see? And is there anything that is of a glaring urgency that needs to be addressed, particularly when it comes to women and their rights being protected as a result of this pandemic?
Protected by whom? Again, we come to the issue of agency. You know, women have to stand together. Women have to fight that, you know, for their rights and a decent way of living. We must look as women, the two or three of us who are not in that situation, we have to look at our grandchildren, our children, our sisters, our mothers, the other women, and see what is it in our society that enables this kind of pandemic. You know, the president a week or so ago said, you know, it's a pandemic, the violence against women. I wrote, you know, in my one book of poetry, there's a poem, Victims of an Undeclared War. I'm talking about women. That was more almost 20 years ago this book was published. So this is not new. What has happened with the you know, present health issue, the COVID-19, it has laid bare our nakedness as a nation, who we are. And unless, you know, no problem comes when you are 18 or when you are 28. It starts at birth. If the child doesn't get the necessary prerequisite, really, direction and nurturing and guidance from right at the beginning, in fact, when the child is in the mother's womb, she will become poor because she will make wrong choices. You know, our life is, you know, when we are born, we are equal. Nobody's richer than us. It is what will be poured into that human being that will make a difference. What are we pouring into our, you know, we are village South Africa. The African saying, it takes a village to raise a child. What is happening to our village? That our children are murderers, our children are rapists, and our children, the girl child, the woman, is still a dependent even when they are older. No woman should be anybody's. Those days are gone. My mother, her mother, maybe when they were raised in the village, the only future they could look forward to was to be somebody's wife. Today we are not raising girls for that. But we have left our rights behind us. Asitombisi, we don't initiate girls, and I don't mean cutting, but you know, the transition from childhood to womanhood, we have not replaced it with anything. Our children just growing up and growing up, and when they are 15, they think the sign for being grown is to have a baby. Where is the village? And we know the situation of single parenting, that children are either being raised by one person or not raised by any grown-up at all, or the poor grandmother is raising six children. We know that. What are we doing as society? The child grant is not enough. It's not enough money. And if the statistics are right, and I have no reason to doubt them, poverty is growing in South Africa. So it's not mitigating, it's not hitting the target. Whatever the target is, it's not changing the lives of poor people. It may keep them from actually dying, but is that the life you want? To just not die? Is that quality of life? To be kept alive for what purpose? If your life is such a pittance, you can hardly feed yourself. There is nothing in your life that is worthwhile. Everybody, all God's children on earth, should live lives that are worth having.
Sure. That's incredibly profound, Dr. Magona. I think you've highlighted there so many things that kind of, like, you know, tick at my heartstring. But I come back to this point around reminding everybody that we are all called here to do something with our lives. And it's really sad when you see a society, particularly women, regressing back as a result of not being able to be given, you know, the fair opportunity to lift themselves up. So thank you so much for, you know, giving us such a good food for thought and a segue into this conversation. What I'm going to do is I'm going to call Shimmy up on our virtual stage. But to our audience, please, please take this opportunity to ask Dr. Magona as many questions as possible. We are going to, at a later stage, bring her onto the virtual stage and address some of those questions. So thank you, Dr. Magona. See you
thank
in a
you.
Little bit. All right.
You.
Thank you so much. So we're going to call up next. We have the vivacious and pow-pow Shimmy Isaacs. Shimmy is an award-winning comedian. Hi, Shimmy.
I'm laughing at that intro already. Vivacious. I love it.
You know, she's an award-winning comedian, writer, and actress. She has shared with us thus that being part of this conversation is of great importance to her. As a performer and a writer, she focuses a lot on social issues surrounding women, particularly women of color. She has been a lecturer and at the acting department at AFTA in Cape Town. And she's made her stand-up comedy debut in 2011 at the Vodacom Funny Festival at the Baxter Theatre. And she has represented South Africa on various international stages and has taken numerous awards there. And in 2019, she was the creator and screenwriter for the sitcom Frida, which we all know of and appreciate. She's currently the head writer for a feature rom-com comedy and films at Gambit Films Production Company. Welcome, Shimmy, and what a lovely shirt you've got on.
Thank you, Boo. Thank you, Boo. Wow, what an intro. What an intro. You know, because we just keep going and we just keep doing, and when you hear everything that you've done, you kind of go, oh, wow, that's a lot, and that's not even half of it. So thank you.
100%. So Shimmy, you were once asked in an interview if you ever found yourself auditioning for a music reality TV show, what song would you sing to and why? And so your answer was, it would be The Man's World, because I'm a woman working in a male-dominated industry. So when I read that, it reminded me of this jarring interview I once saw online, where the cast of Once Upon a Time in Hollywood was being interviewed by this journalist, I think in New York. So in the interview was Quentin Tarantino, Brad Pitt, and Margot Robbie. What I found jarring about this interview was the journalist completely ignored Margot Robbie for most of the interview, perhaps because he was starstruck by Brad Pitt and Tarantino. I don't know why, because she's a brilliant actress in her own right. But this interview reflected for me what tends to happen when you are the only woman in the room. We tend to get swallowed up in what I call masculinity. And some of these men tend to forget you exist. You know, it just does not happen in your industry, but I wanted to make an example, you know, from your industry. It happens everywhere. I've experienced it in corporate and so forth. So, yeah. So you know, what are your views on that?
Well, first of all, I'm no Margot Robbie and I'm not white, so I definitely would have said something, you know, and I think women need to understand when we as a people of color talk about, you know, claiming spaces, that's one of the things that we as women also have to do. I make sure that when I do, and I am a female in a very male dominated industry within stand up comedy, but the distinction here is that I am faster, better, and I'm quicker on my feet than many of the men on stage. So I've given them a run for their money. Okay. And I unapologetically say that because I'm great at what it is that I do. So first of all, I don't enable being ignored. And I think sometimes women, we are not rooted in our definement as women. We don't stand in our authentic truth. And that sometimes sort of wavers us from our standpoint. So that's the first thing I would say, is that I come into any industry of entertainment with many, many, many years of experience. I'm a graduate. I've got several degrees under my belt. And that in itself, you know, gives me a seat at the table. And so when we say claim space, we also need you to claim your voice, speak up.
Amazing. Now bringing back to our current reality, this issue of race and an identity has been exacerbated by what has been unfolding during COVID and due to Black Lives Matters. You know, when I first met you, we bumped into each other at the prom, and what we had in common is that a lot of people seem to think that it's an issue that sits and rests with America or Americans. We as South Africans have made peace with it. We've moved past it, particularly when, you know, Madiba was inaugurated as our president in 94. But we know that the reality isn't so. So can you share your honest view of what your thoughts are and maybe some of your top three precepts we need to change when it comes to things pertaining to race, identity, and gender-related issues?
Well, look, the Black Lives Movement is nothing new to me, and I don't think it is anything new to South Africans. You know, back in the 1960s, we had Steve Biko, who was at the forefront of Black consciousness. Okay, and that's what we need to understand, is really what is it that, what is the message of Black Lives Matter and of Black consciousness? And what that message is that we are saying to neoliberal, especially to our white counterparts, that you cannot just say that you believe in a democracy, but you don't value our lives. And that is the important thing that we're saying here, is even to us as a Black people, we cannot just say we believe in a democracy, but we don't value our own lives. That's the important distinction that we have to make here. And when we look at the purpose of what Black consciousness was, we weren't just asking, and that is what Black Lives Matter within this time, 2020, has highlighted once again. We're not just looking for physical liberation. But the important thing here is we're looking for psychological liberation. And it is important that those who do not look like us or sound like us needs to have some serious psychological transformation into understanding what Black lives truly mean and how to value that. And that is the important thing here. White people or people who don't look like us, those that do have a privilege, they need to start weaponizing that privilege.
Agreed.
Yeah, that's the important thing. Understand your privilege and then weaponize that for the people and alongside the people that you know have been marginalized. Mm-hmm. Because yes, it's fine for us as a people of color to stand out there and protest. But once again, we're not looking for structural political change. That's not the only thing that we're looking for in this time. We need psychological transformation in the minds of those who do not look like us, who don't sound like us, and especially who don't behave like us culturally.
Mm-hmm. So now, like, can I would like to just add in a small question there, like, just maybe share your views from, like, you know, having worked in this, you know, primarily male-dominated industry that is a powerful tool for telling stories. Stories are one way in which we can change narratives. What would you like to see happen, you know, particularly coming from people of your industry that have the platforms and the influence to do so?
Well, first of all, it's not just about changing narrative, but it's really about changing perception. Okay. I mean, in my honors year, I focused my thesis on the representation of women in color within film, television, and theater. And that's what is important, is that we've got people sitting at the table making decisions for us, about us, without us. So, which is why I decided as a writer, producer, and actress to take back my narrative and start to create my own storylines. That is the important thing. I, in particular, focus on stories where people who look like me and you are heroes, you know, because I do think that even our struggles and poverty tends to become glamorized in the industry of entertainment to make a buck or two. Okay, but we don't see the story of the father or mother that gets up at 5 a.m. and do their damnest to give their children the best life or best education possible, which in my case, my mother only had grade 9. My father only had grade 11, and yet they still had the foresight to send to an all-white school, okay, because they understood that my power is going to lie within my intellectual property and within my knowledge. So, basing this on gender, I am not afraid to walk into an all-male room. That's the important thing. I am not scared because I consist of as much information as you do, and sometimes more, about the topic at hand. You know, my dad left at the age of 15. I had to work in the yard. I had to change light bulbs. So I never ever was raised to the extent that I couldn't do something because there was a man in the house. If you wanted something done, as my mother would say, do it yourself. So again, when we look at gender equality, okay, in my time, I really hope that we get there. Okay, but it is at this stage, it seems like it's something that I probably won't see in my lifetime. But that doesn't mean that we cannot run companies. At the age that I'm 38 years old, darling, I have created many shows. I have given many men work, many men as much as women. I have employed. So at the end of the day, I am just as capable as they are, and sometimes better at it.
Mm. Sure. Thanks for that. That's why I say you powwow, Shimmy. I mean, take that. And the key message that I'm getting here is, as women or anybody, just own it and show up. Show up to life and show up to what's handed to you, yeah?
Yes. Well, also, don't limit yourself by labeling yourself, okay? Because a lot of the times I do forget that I'm an actual female. You know, it doesn't mean that it doesn't register, but I don't limit myself when I'm creating something by telling myself, oh, I can't do this because I'm colored, or because I'm, you know, bilingual, or because I'm a female. And in that way, we've got internal censorship that happens in particular with women. And we just need to move, we need to surpass the internal censorship that we give ourselves. Mm-hmm. You know, it is really giving yourself the permission, because you can have all the blessings at your feet, but if you don't give yourself the permission to reposition yourself and step into that position that your higher power has set out for you, you will probably feel that you cannot do it.
Sure.
And yeah,
Thanks so much, Shimmy. Some lots of food for thought there. I'm going to call up to our virtual stage, Dr. Eve, but you've given us a lot of fire shots, and she is the queen of psychological liberation, so to say.
Yay!
So, Dr. Eve, I'm going to call you up on the stage. And she's our last speaker for the day before we take questions from you as the audience. So I encourage you to please keep them coming. Like, we have a very vocal, an audience that is challenging the status quo. This is your opportunity to ask your questions, or even perhaps just leave some comments, some food for thought that we can discuss as a collective when I bring all the speakers up. So up on our virtual stage, we have Dr. Eve. Dr. Eve is an internationally trained and accredited couple sex therapist, clinical psychologist who runs her own private practice. Dr. Eve first took on the TEDx stage in 2015. I was actually present at that one engaged in your talk, which I found quite insightful, around cyber infidelity, the new seduction. I encourage you also to please, if you have not watched that, please go and watch it on YouTube. It is thought-provoking and very relevant for the current kind of new normal we're living in. Dr. Eve has also become known and has lectured internationally about cyber infidelity, complex relationships in the digital age, intimacy, and is very well versed around this topic of trauma. Welcome, Dr. Eve.
Hi, Mosidi. So nice to be back with the TED family again. Thank you for having me.
Fantastic. So, Dr. Eve, you're very synonymous with the work you do around sexuality, and had a great run with your podcast, which with Eusebius McKaiser, bringing in what might be taboo topics to the nation. So you address in some of your episodes trauma at great lengths and highlight that this trauma is not always one-sided. So, oftentimes the man tends to be the villain and then the woman the victim. But you address that sometimes it goes two ways. You have men that are wounded who show up who show those wounds in relationships, and have women that have become traumatized as a result of the pain that they did not inflict on this man, but the situation can go vice versa, where women are the ones traumatized or wounded, and then they show up in relationships inflicting trauma upon the spouse. So you understand the concept of trauma very, very well. So in what way has the collective trauma worsened, particularly in South Africa, as a result of COVID-19?
Well, that's a big mouthful. That's a whole lot to take on, Mosidi. Let me kind of backtrack a little and put it into a context of micro, meso, and macro context for all of us, so we better understand what we're talking about. I was just a little overwhelming, the whole idea of trauma. I do want to say, because we're talking about gender equity, and the focus is, of course, on how do we gain equity for women, that even though women may be abusive towards men, that's really, I don't want to segue into that space at all. When we talk about on a micro violent level, it is about women being incredibly abused by men. And listening to Shimmy and her incredible activism and confidence around women having a voice and standing out, all that I was feeding in that space was, wow, there are so many women who risk their lives, who may be beaten to death, violated, or raped because they raise their voice. And it's something that we do need to be aware of, that we do not want to shame or blame women who might be present with us right now, who want to have a voice or do have a voice in their jobs, in their everyday, in their lives. But actually, when they get home or when they're in bed with a partner, they're not able to voice themselves as a woman at all. And that's because there is a huge collective trauma that exists around women. The collective trauma in our country, which has been born by colonialism, by apartheid, and now even since then, patriarchy, which is ongoing and always will be present, in our country. We know this brings collective trauma. And what does that feel like? That brings an underlying sense of anxiety and tension into all of us. So we kind of walk around with a certain level of aggression, which we are in defensive or offensive mode. And this plays out in our bedrooms. This plays out in our intimate relationships with each other. So if we look at my stance that I'm working with right now in terms of men's trauma and why they perpetrate trauma on women, and I'm saying this not as an excuse, in fact, just the opposite, because I feel very strongly that we need to be understanding men, using compassion and kindness in order to bring about change in their behavior so we can better work, protect women, so that women can thrive in the way that they need to be thriving. So we know from research that men are abused as children, that men are witness to abuse, that they are victims of childhood, either emotional, physical, sexual abuse and poverty, because we need to look at the context. And as a result of that, there is direct trauma, which is affected upon them. And they are living at a level of higher anxiety, frustration. And if you're in a context, certainly like COVID-19, where there is unemployment and there's fear of loss of job and of health, that escalates, which is why we've seen such a high incidence of gender-based violence globally, because in this time, and also, as you mentioned just now, Mosidi, suicide has gone up so much more as people are feeling this desperation. So we've got a collective trauma, which then impacts on us individually. So men are in a space where they are just ready to go. They're ready to lash out. They're ready to violate. And who are they going to take it out on? They're going to take it out on women. So my work really is geared towards what can we do for men and how can we work with the trauma that men have to be able to get men to be much more present in a more mindful way, so they're able to contain impulses, so they don't turn to alcohol, to drugs, to gambling, to risky sexual behavior in order to calm themselves down. So my work is very much around mindfulness and working in it through a trauma lens, to be able to work in the intimacy of couples' lives so that men can learn to be quiet, and obviously women would then feel safer and more protected.
Thank you so much. And I must add and commend you for the work that you're doing in terms of, you know, helping parents or giving them a framework by which they can discuss sexuality with their children. I'm part of this accelerator, and one of the girls who's a part of it as well, she was so happy. Like, she was just like, I can't wait for you to be engaging with Dr. Eve, because when I was 15 or something, my mom bought me this book, and I was like, how was it? She's like, I just thoroughly, appreciated it. And so it speaks to this notion around, we need, yes, that one, Dr. Eve 6. And we need a society where parents need to have a degree of openness around, you know, issues that are taboo, particularly in this world where it is hyper-connected. You know, children are always at risk of misinformation as a result of social media and so forth. What would be your advice to parents raising kids in this hyper-digitized world that has a lot of risks out there?
I think that during this time of COVID-19, Mosidi, it was so essential and such a great opportunity, which is what I really pushed for whilst parents were doing education of their children, that they needed to incorporate sexuality education into their children's curriculum whilst they were at home as well. And people kind of get really scared. Parents get really scared around, how am I going to talk to my children about sexuality? But let's kind of break it down and make it feel more comfortable for parents around what sexuality education is. Because we know from the research that kids from age 9 are watching pornography. They're learning about sexuality from pornography, and they think that that's the norm. They think that that is the way that sexuality has to happen, in that kind of entertaining and really very theatrical manner. And that impacts on them as they get older, in terms of impacts on women specifically, around what the expectation is that men have around their sexuality. So parents need to be talking about sexuality education around self-esteem. Definitely the big thing is around consent and coercion. What is the difference between the two? Knowing also about gender and microaggressions. So, so important to be able to pick up on minute microaggressions that are happening in the home. Because I believe that we've got policies, we've got all of these incredible laws in this country, but we still have this incredible war on women, this violence that happens. So I kind of don't work in that area, but I feel that each one of us can make a huge difference in our own homes, in our own communities, by noticing the microaggressions that happen in your home, between your children, where there is a different way of managing and treating boy children, girl children, children who are trans, children who are binary, non-binary. So we need to be really noticing those things and working respectfully with our children and their bodies and their diversity, and recognizing that there isn't just a binary. So those are the messaging that we need to be giving children to prepare them to be healthy sexual adults as they get older.
Fantastic. Thank you so much for those valuable insights. And I'm sure there's a lot of parents where this is great food for thought for them. Yeah. Now I want to segue into this issue around celebrating Women's Month. So yeah. You vocally shared with us that you have a view around it. So commonly in South Africa come March, corporates throw, you know, a lot of money into dressing up a room with pink roses and having MCC flowing to commend women for how great they are. But the reality is that women tend to be the subset of people who tend to be more marginalized in the work environments. And, you know, the unrelenting leaders actually don't know their struggles. Like, I remember one time just seeing this Twitter feed started by a mother who was denied a sick leave to go and look after her child or something. And it was just astounding what was coming up from these parents. And it was primarily women of color feeling discriminated against, that their bosses don't understand or know, you know, their current situation. So you recently published an open letter against celebrating Women's Day, citing we should ditch the concept altogether. Can you tell us a bit about why you have such a strong view about that?
I think that the original historical notion in 1956 of Women's Day, you know, is incredibly relevant. It was so powerful to have women marching and being that brave, and mostly, you know, women of color marching around past laws. So I don't take away from that at all. But, you know, today it's incredibly different, and I feel it's almost patronizing to say we need to have a day for women. I mean, seriously, what does that mean? Or a month for women? Why not rather look at women every day and say, how can we really honor, respect them, and show kindness and compassion to them, rather than having this whole month? And also, I feel that Mosidi, that the focus is on women. Women need to protect themselves. Women need to take better care. Women need to make sure that we don't walk around in certain places, that architecture is designed in a way that women are protected. It's nonsense. The focus needs to be on men, and only on men, to be able to, how do we manage ourselves that we are able to be safe for women, that women can feel safe around us. It's not women who can do anything at all. So that's why I wrote this open letter to men, to get them to really be mindful and to be taking notice of their own actions, whether it's at home or in the workplace, around things like, do you know the difference between, as I said, consent and coercion? Mm-hmm. Do you know the microaggressions that happen? The small little comments that you're making, the little emojis that you're sending to your female colleague that you don't even realize, listening to one of your colleagues talking or describing a woman, that's where you've got to intervene. You know, you can't be a bystander. You have to be present and pointed out. And that's incredibly difficult for people to do. Mm-hmm. And then to be aware of sexual harassment in the workplace, which we know, you know, really got the whole Me Too movement going in America a few years ago. This whole notion of there is just so much discrimination and harassment around women, and women started to speak up. And the consequences, even in America, have not been good for women. Because even though the men may have been noticed and sent off to jail or have got some kind of consequence to them, what has happened to those women is that they can't find jobs because they're seen as telltale. So they're still discriminated against. So there has to be a huge education around sexual harassment in the workplace as well.
How do we educate our boy children? Because it seems as though, like, you know, Shimmy raised something around, like, you know, we might not see these radical changes in our lifetime, but perhaps in our children or our children's children. How do we educate our boy children to be mindful of these things that you have brought up?
It's really working with stereotypes and myths and beliefs and stories and narratives that exist. It's the same with racism, sexism, with any kind of homophobia, LGBTIQA phobia that exists. It's about being in the moment. I keep coming back to being in the moment, being present with your child. So when your child makes a remark that is sexist, you talk to it immediately. You want to be on top of the things that your children are looking at, the kind of porn they're watching, the music videos that they're looking at, and to talk to it. The series that they're watching on Netflix, whatever they're doing, how they're engaging, you want to talk to it in the moment and to say, that's not the kind of values that we have in this home. We don't believe in that. This is what we do instead. We treat our girl children the same way. It's about showing how to treat each other with respect, kindness, and compassion equally, no matter what your gender is. It's being present with your children. And that takes, you know, a lot for parents who are really quite inundated because of their own trauma and because of their own busyness. It's very difficult to parent so very present, to be so very present in the parenting of your child. And that's the only thing that I really believe is going to make a difference.
I couldn't agree more. There's a book Dr. Shefali wrote called The Conscious Parent. And I'm not a parent, but I gifted it to a couple of friends who are now parents. And the ones who've read it said they found it so invaluable around, you know, remember also as a parent, you are a mere conduit, you know, for this child into this planet. They have the choice of free will to do whatever they want with their lives, but it is up to you to kind of mold and shape what you know, their precepts or their mindsets are. You have no control, but all you can do is just do your level best to shape it for the positive. So thank you so much for those insightful information. So I'm going to call back up on stage, our virtual stage, Dr. Magona and Shimmy. Dr. Eve, stay right where you are. And then we're going to segue into this, my favorite part of the evening, where we take questions from you, the audience. I'm going to pull them up here, and then we'll distribute them freely. So Dr. Magona, Dr. Eve, Shimmy, you are most welcome to take them, but there are some where you know, they've been addressed at each of you respectfully. So the first question from Dambi Sahara is for Shimmy and Dr. Eve. Their question is, how do we as women overcome the imposter syndrome?
The imposter syndrome. Should I just go ahead and answer, Mosidi? I mean, I don't know if Shimmy's disappeared too.
Okay. I'm you're much older than me, so go. Now it's a cultural thing. My eldest girl before me. There we go.
A respect of elders. Finally, I've reached the stage where I get respect for being old. Oh my goodness, I've always wanted this. So the imposter syndrome really comes from low self-esteem, from brought up and educated in a way in a family where you're not led to believe that you're worthwhile and valuable. And that's what we can kind of start with in terms of educating. And that's where the trauma comes in for young people of not having parents who are self-regulated, as we call it in trauma world, self-regulated and able to be present as a parent, but perhaps dealing with their own trauma. And so not possible to really be there to give you that belief in yourself, that feeling that not only the resilience, but the feeling that, you know, you are really special, that you are really unique, and that there is obstacles that you're going to be able to manage on your own. And so it's, you know, it's a very irritating experience to have this imposter syndrome. It can be very healthy in one way, in a small way, because it encourages you to fight harder, work harder, think harder. But if it gets in the way of your thinking, you're not going to achieve anything, and then it becomes a loop.
Yeah. Shimmy, anything to...
Yes, I mean, I have a bit of a different take on this. I'm not a doctor. I'm merely just speaking from my own personal experience and journey, because, again, I'm a child of divorce. And I think for a long time, you know, I had a certain expectation from my parents. First of all, they were incapable because they themselves did not have the tools. So history story.
We've lost Shimmy there for a bit, but hopefully she'll come up. Hi, Shimmy. No. Okay. All right. I will give Shimmy an opportunity to address the question at a later stage. I'm going to move on to the next question. Thank you very much for that question, Dambisa. And it's going to be addressed at you, Dr. Magona. You know, the question is, the problems we face are so complex. Where do we start? I have a few thoughts on this, but honestly, I feel helpless in the grand scheme of things. Like, Dr. Magona, your story is a story of, you know, overcoming complexity and having to be resilient over it. What's your response to Ruth's question?
It's complex, but life is complex. But if you look at it, take a look from a different angle, it's quite simple. We are given at birth. Doesn't matter where you are born, what color your parents are, what social, you know, how rich, how poor, we have equal opportunity at birth. What happens between genders, between races, is what society puts into the children. It's as simple as that. That's why, you know, poor parents raise children who will become poor parents. You know, this, you know, it's self, you know, propelling, you know, it goes on and on. Every system reproduces itself. And we as individuals, you have to take a stand at one point. If you have the courage, if you have the awareness to say, I'm done with this, I don't want to be in this anymore, that's where socialization is so crucial. Because everything we know as human beings, we were not born with that knowledge. We have all learned it. It was taught to us. That's why in South Africa, for instance, it's really stupid, if not short-sighted, let me be polite, to think people who were raised during apartheid would have escaped being racist. I'm not saying all, but the majority of white South Africans cannot help it. I'm saying that's an excuse. It's a fact. Just as Black children in South Africa to this day cannot help having some sense of inferiority. You read the studies, by the time a Black child is 4 or 5, most of the children know it's better to be white. Look at how children in kindergarten go to school with white hair. It's all a question of village South Africa coming to its senses and saying the buck stops here. We missed the opportunity in 1994. How long are we going to wait for real freedom? Something is not right. We all know that. Don't we stand up and say, this is the change with us now? Every system perpetuates itself. You have to end up here and change now. If you expect people who live in shacks to raise children, they're going to go to Harvard. You think it's not going to happen? It is more poor people. Where do we stop? We see crime, the same thing. And the money is there. The resources are there. Why do we not spend our resources as a nation at the front end of a person's life? Why do we wait until they're in Portsmouth before we start intervening in any meaningful way? Because you're in jail, you can't stay, you can't be educated, you can't choose. You can't teach you what you can't teach you. Why? It's a question of the grown-ups children themselves. In this country, sitting down and saying, guys, we have lost the way, what do we do? Meaningfully. Lockdown, if we need to have lockdown for 5 years as a country, not against, you know, COVID-19, it's a disaster we have become. Automatically. Sorry.
Do you have something to add on to that, Dr. Ruth? I mean, Dr. Eve, sorry.
It's okay. People do that. So yes, I do want to add on to that. You know, I'm with Dr. Magona in terms of what she's saying, and I see and hear her frustration. I would also be sweating with frustration and anger around the situation in our country, around women and race. I do want to say, just to put in kind of a bit of a scientific lens onto what she has said, is that we now have really good research that talks about something called epigenetics. And epigenetics means that we inherit trauma, that on our genes, there is a gene which is now attached, which is a trauma gene, just to put it very simply, and that it's passed down in the womb from mothers who have been traumatized to their children who've been traumatized to their children who've been traumatized. So it's not that we're all kind of born equal. We're not. We are born with a history and a proclivity to have trauma. And then we put into certain structures and we put into certain situations where, you know, the tip of the iceberg looks like this, but actually there's just so much discrimination for women, for people of color, that your chances of being violated as a woman are incredibly high. The chances of you being traumatized, your chances of you being at high risk are there. So, you know, there's a cycle, what you call the cycle of poverty. There is a cycle of trauma that continues generation to generation. And, you know, how do we stop that trauma? How do we stop that trauma so it doesn't go from intergeneration? And for me as a clinician, obviously this is what my training is. I can't work with the whole nation, but I certainly do work with individuals to teach them, parents, to teach them how to calm themselves down, to be better parents, to parent better. I also just want to do a shout out around my new radio show that I have started, which I'm really proud about, that Cape Talk and Radio 702 have given me a space with Aubrey Masango every second Thursday night. And the show is only around trauma. We only talk about trauma, and we have a community that we've created that people can come in and can talk about their trauma, because we know that from community and from being in forum and from telling stories, it's a great way to begin to heal some kinds of trauma.
Fantastic. I look forward to that. And I think the moment is so opportune with this pandemic. It's going through the roof. As we speak, there's somebody out there going through a traumatic experience, and they need safe spaces that are inclusive and accessible to be able to reach out to somebody. So I hope there's great awareness and marketing that goes behind it, because there's a dire need for it at this point in time. So I'm going to throw another question from Babalo. It's a brilliant one, where it says, American Corner Cape Town recently had a talk that said, can men be allies in the fight against gender-based violence? I would like to ask the speakers, how can men be allies in the pursuit of the decade of women?
Okay, so who goes first?
You can go if you want. Oh,
go.
You know, in life, there are two. In this lack of equity, there are two. You are comparing. When you say it's not equal, it means that one is lower than the other. Mm. Oppressor, oppressed. Rich, poor. Something like that. Men are born boys or men. It doesn't make that person automatically a prospective abuser. They can be in a position to talk to their brothers, to talk to their friends, to talk to their employers. We are all agents as social beings. We are social beings. We can work for the good of all. Mm-hmm. The thing is, the trauma we're talking about for women and poor people, in Xhosa, we say, it's a gazin. I wrote a whole, not with the long word the doctor used there, you know, but in simple writing, we say it's in the blood.
Yeah.
There are things that happen that you feel or you fear or you love, not because of things that happened to you, because of something that happened to your great, great, great grandfather. You know, trauma runs in our bones, in our blood. So now, men should, men of conscience, should stand up by preventing by talking to their brothers and by just saying this is not right.
Mm.
It's like racism.
Yeah.
It's not racism. What never was only the fight of black people in South Africa. There were people who were not black, white South Africans who joined because they saw that it was wrong and had the courage. In fact, that was part of how we, you know, don't tell me you're not a racist if you're not in the fight against racism.
Mm.
You know, the same thing now with gender-based violence. Don't tell me you don't, if you are a man who doesn't join the fight. I am the age, I am older than everybody here. And I grew up, I didn't know about, you know, complex sexualities. I didn't know what a gay person was until I was in my mid, you know, 20s. I didn't know the word lesbian. But today, if people who are, who have a different, sexual orientation are matching, if they invite me, I'll be there. Because it's not enough for me to say I am not homophobic. Mm-hmm. I joined my daughters for equality. And to talk to mothers and parents or grandmothers my age, because they don't understand, to say, don't wait until it's your own daughter. Don't wait until somebody. Discrimination, hate is hate. We shouldn't hate anybody without reason. And men must end up in this fight against gender-based violence.
You hit it on the nail, Dr. Eve. Thanks, Dr.
Yeah, yeah. I think, you know, just like there's structural racism, there's structural patriarchy, and there is so much toxic masculinity, and there is so much sense of entitlement that I don't think in my lifetime I'm going to be witness to men really getting out of this patriarchal system and men really letting go, loosening their entitlement in a way that's going to be beneficial to women, that men are going to feel comfortable having a woman equal by their side. I mean, just today I was working with a woman who is very privileged and she still to this day gets handouts from her husband of money. Mm. She still waits for him to give her bits of money every day so she can go and, you know, do shopping. And this is a woman privileged with intelligence and with education. So how, you know, that and he will tell me he totally wants her to be free and he's totally invested in equity and they totally have equal roles and he's very grateful to her for, you know, helping him in his business. But when it comes down to bottom line, you know, he holds the control still. And then, you know, she comes to me because she doesn't have any desire. Well, he brings her to me because she doesn't have any desire to be sexual. You know, why not? Well, because, you know, he treats her from a place of patriarchy and entitlement and she doesn't feel safe and secure. So how can she ever be sexual with this man? She can't. So how are we going to shift that for men? I think it's going to take many generations that we do it.
Mm. And the other question to follow is to you both is empowering women the answer to solving poverty? This question is from Ayanda. Dr. Magona, do you want to take that one?
Oh, definitely. But as I say, not when they are already women. I mean, I'm not saying people who are grown already should be abandoned. We should start at grassroots. The child must grow up knowing, you know, they trust themselves, they love themselves, they respect themselves and know that they are as good as anybody. They must work hard to have the life they want. They must make the right choices, choices that will not hurt their goals. Goal setting, all that. Empowering women is not giving them anything more than helping them become the best they can be. They already have the wherewithal. With all the things we've been through, but we do need the help of parenting, which is not here for most of our children. Good parenting, guidance, nurturing, that kind of thing. That's where that the empowering. And I'm not saying let's forget about the ones who are, but you know, let's grow them strong and healthy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, nobody's going to give women their freedom. Women have to build themselves and one another. towards that. Yes, empowerment. And through empowering women, we will empower their children and society.
Fantastic. Dr. Eve, anything to add there?
Yeah, I'm busy learning around poverty and racism, and mostly around what's called intersectionality. And when you look at poverty being here under what's called the ice, you know, the tip of the iceberg, and we look at what's in the top of the iceberg. So people were present with things like alcohol addiction, prison sentences, sexual acting out, domestic violence, gender-based violence, incest, this kind of behavior. And when you look underneath and you go down to the different intersections of what creates what's on top of the iceberg, what we see, you know, what we see is not really what there is. It's way more complex. And right at the bottom of that iceberg, what lies at the bottom is poverty. Mm. So it's not just about saying we're going to empower women and therefore we're going to eradicate poverty at all. We have to work with each different section to be able to really get down to the roots of it. And that includes, you know, gender equity, recognition of exactly what you're saying, of how do we get women to feel of value to themselves? Mm. And it's a hard ask. It's a hard ask.
And just an add-on question, it's perhaps the last one for this moment before we start closing up. There's a comment here from Shantae. She says, as a young female embarking on my career, I often find that women break one another down in the hopes of climbing the ladder faster. What can we do as women to navigate situations like this? I 100% agree with her. It does not... in the career landscape, it happens within, you know, your surrounding perceived circles of love.
The sisterhood, huh? Doesn't work so well in business. So this glass ceiling, I agree with that. What we know about young girls is, and Dr. Magona was talking about socialization just now, is that young girls are socialized to be very affiliative, meaning very pleasing, very charming, and very kind, and very sweet. That's how they socialize. But if they were not socialized in that way, they, at the core, they would be aggressive and chasing and competitive and quite bitchy. And that comes out, you know, when it's a survival mechanism of like, here we are in the corporate and I'm going to do whatever to get there. And are we any different to men? No, we really are not. At the end of the day, we're people and we're driven by survival, and survival therefore forces us to be highly competitive and to be able to adapt to whatever we need in that moment. And if it means pushing the sister down, we're going to push that sister down because I need to get to the top is very great.
Mm. Dr. Magona, anything to add there?
It's very sad, but it's true that women will play against one another to win. Look at the sad thing of young men going around having babies in a line of women because woman number three, he will marry me. He has a child there and a child there, and you still give him a child. That's again competition that really doesn't do anybody any good, especially the children. But you see, we have become caught up in a situation where, you know, we are in a system, socio-economic system, that is based on competition. That's the Western way. The traditional way was cooperation. Hmm. Look who's here.
Shimmy's back.
Cooperation. Back. And we have lost.
Hi, Ma.
So it is sad. And I, you know, what can we do about it? But something needs to be done. Again, it goes back to how the woman, values herself. If you don't respect, you must respect yourself. You can't respect others if you don't respect yourself.
100% agree. Shimmy, did you manage to catch on some of those questions that were asked? Are there any of them that are burning, like, you know, you have burning comments towards them? We've still got time.
Well, I heard a little bit here and there of what Dr. Sindiwe and Dr. Eve were saying. But I think what stuck in my mind was the last bit of what I wanted to say.
Yeah.
You know, which is very important. And I think this relates to what Dr. Sindiwe is talking about. You know, the change you want to see is the change that you need to start applying. You know, so the need for wanting to be recognized, you need to recognize yourself. The need for wanting equal pay, ask for it, because I do. And I'm not saying that everybody out there is like me. And yes, we have structural barriers and institutional racism and things that we kind of need to overcome. But at the end of the day, only you are in control of your narrative. Only you have the power and the consent. The consent over your own destiny, no one else.
Dr. Magona? Yes.
What you just said remind me of how I stumbled on the truth in my mid-20s. That's how angry I was. I'm the one who's abandoned. Societal attitudes. I'm the stupid woman, Ubandile. She was cold. She couldn't keep her man. I got so angry. There's a government that doesn't recognize me. I went, despite the government, I'm talking about the apartheid government, despite the government, in spite of the government, to spite the government, I will be something. Mm. I wasn't throwing my life because other people said I'm rubbish.
Mm. Yeah, that power of that power is like, it all comes down to you telling yourself that I can and I will, end of story. Now, we're going to wrap up.
Despite everything, yes.
Despite everything, COVID, you know, unfavorable circumstances, because the mind is powerful. It goes where you want to take it at the end of the day. But in wrapping up, I would like to just segue to you, Shimmy. We didn't speak at great length around the role of leadership and how it is an important key in the cog in attaining gender equity, you know, in the next 10 years. So, you know, I was watching this video with Sharon Stone yesterday, telling a harrowing story.
Oh, wow.
I don't know if you've seen it, her family suffering from COVID under Donald Trump. And she said something that stuck with me, that the only countries that are going to do while coping with COVID are the ones that have women in leadership. And she told the American audience to vote for Joe Biden and Kamala Harris, because if Kamala Harris is as a woman there, with her lens and her lived experience, particularly as a woman of color, change will come. Her family might not actually have been at the risk of dying of COVID as a result of bad policies that were inflicted by Donald Trump.
Yeah.
Take Jacinta Thornton, I think that's her surname, Arden, when there was a bombing in the mosque. She led with empathy and compassion and realized that this is a situation that is a byproduct of a polarized society. And I have to apply my EQ and empathy as a woman to navigate this harrowing experience. So what can we do in the next 10 years to advance female leaders? Because it's clear that women in leadership are the answer here, particularly women of color.
I've said this to you before, I think, Modise, in one of our chats we had. We need to organize and we need to mobilize. I think that a lot of us on our keyboards, and we hide behind those keyboards, but it's time for us to come out from behind those keyboards and join people in the actual fight, you know, because when we look back, I'm a child of apartheid. When we go back into the 80s, 70s and 60s, we didn't have the internet. We didn't have social media, you know, and in today's time, it really lends itself to change, right? For change. But that's exactly what we have to do. We need to organize and we need to mobilize and strategize as women together, black, colored, white, pink, whatever your melanin is, we need to come together, organize and mobilize, because that's the only way that we're going to beat the system, because it is a system. It's a system of oppression still upon us. through a new lens. And of course, women are important to leadership. I was raised by a single mother. We were three girls. And if it wasn't for her leadership in discipline, I don't think that I would be the person that I am today, standing in my truth, but also being able to love my enemy, even if he doesn't love me back. Mm-hmm. And that's something that we as people of color is rooted in us. You can lynch us, you can whoop us as many times as you want. We will look up to you and say, I don't want no trouble. I didn't come here for trouble. Mm-hmm. And that's a poem that will always sit in the back of my head, you know, when we listen to Nina Simone. When people show you who they are, believe them. Believe them.
Fantastic. In fact, I'm just going to change gear a bit and segue to you in closing, Dr. Magona. You say somewhere that, like, if your husband did not leave you, you wouldn't be the woman that you are. So your courage is what effectively made you. And it hinges on Shimmy's comment about her mother's courage, you know, and conviction to raise three girls in the absence of a father. So there are many women that may be listening here or somewhere out there that need to actually, you know, be courageous with their lives. Take those difficult, courageous steps. That is that journey of 1,000 miles that leads to a better path. What word or message do you have for them?
You may think your situation is very bad, but unless you do something to change it for the better, it can and will get worse. Mm-hmm. We celebrate Women's Month. Instead of that, we should look at the issues as those women of the 50s, 1950s did, and organize for, you know, solving today's issues. That was an example, nothing we should just celebrate. Let's celebrate and learn from it and do. Without our action, nothing will change. We have to be engaged. We're not just here. I nearly said to look pretty. At almost 80 years, I was never pretty in my 20s. We're not just here to breathe. We're here to do the work that this country needs. That's why we are in this country. Let's stand up and be counted. Let's not become an endangered species like the rhino and other things. We will. Women's Month is actually an insult. Women's Day to women who are being raped and killed every day. No, let's change the narrative. Let's change right now. What's stopping us? Yeah. Let's organize, come together and fight today's fight.
100%. And that question blends in beautifully to my closing question to Dr. Eve around what needs to happen in the next 10 years that we ensure that men like Harvey Weinstein and Jeffrey Epstein are not given the power to do what they did. And for me, the scary part is that they are poster children that have been put up, like, you know, thanks to Hollywood and so forth. But we have Jeffreys and Harveys roaming around office blocks, roaming around our society, you know, really, really terrified, terrifying women, and robbing them of their youth, some of them, and robbing them of their dignity. What needs to come to an end in this decade to ensure that women can be free from a society full of patriarchy and you know, having their sexual rights inflicted upon?
Okay, so I'm going to give you two answers, one serious and one because we have to lighten this up a little, Mosidi. So the one is that the Harvey Weinsteins and the Jeffrey Epsteins are the men that we live with every day of our lives. So I'm kind of less interested in the sensationalism of high-powered men and much more interested in the women who are murdered right now every 3 hours through intimate partner violence, the women who are living with the men right now. Those are the predators. Those are the men that we need to really be aware of. Their anger, their fear, their out of control behavior that gets them to behave really monstrously towards women and towards their children. So I'm going to come back to the microcosmic of, like, we really need to be giving attention to education of our children, on masculinity and on about gender and all the things that I've already mentioned. I think that that's where change comes. School curriculum, education at home, it's got to start over there. So that's the kind of the serious part of it. And also just like want to notice something really interesting about this panel. Sidi, you haven't said anything, but you know, I was raised by a single mom, and I, as a single mom, raised three children. So we're in the sisterhood, you know. And here we are together on a panel of women who have somehow achieved something or contributed something to the world. So isn't that just an interesting fact?
Wow, beautiful.
Reflective of the women in this country, where the majority of people in our country are raised by women. So come on, you know, we women rule. That's just the fact of it. And then I want to end with something which, as I said, which I think we need is to think about pleasure. And the solution to getting women to really rule is to give women an orgasm. That's what's going to happen. We've got to close the pleasure gap. We've got to find equity. There is a whole movement called Close the Pleasure Gap, where if we had women who were more assured of themselves in bed, if there were women who were more keen to open their voices.
Wow. Too late for me.
This is what I want. We would have women who were happier and men who would feel much better about themselves. So we want to close the orgasm gap and we want to have pleasure. And just to bring a shout out that on the 4th of September, we have World Sexual Health Day, and our focus this year is on pleasure. So let's focus on some pleasure for women.
Amazing. Let's celebrate that. And I'd like to do something with something that hinges on this. It was a word by Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie in her TEDx talk titled "We Should All Be Feminist." She says, "I've chosen to no longer be apologetic for my femaleness and my femininity. And I want to be respected in all of my femaleness because I deserve to be." So to your point, Dr. Eve, around women deserving orgasms, women deserve to embrace and walk into their light and their femininity. And, you know, my call to everybody is that let's do whatever we can to see in this 10 years at least a freer world. And, you know, fairer world for females. And if you are a woman in a leadership position, you know, whether you're in corporate or, you know, within your sphere of influence, when the room doesn't look right or it doesn't feel right, where there's microaggressions or things being perpetuated against women, call them out. Give your sister a leg up if you have the power to be, because that's where change is going to come. I want to thank each and every single one of you here, Dr. Magona, Dr. Eve, Shimmy, for joining us this evening. It was such a prolific, you know, mind-affirming conversation. And to you, the audience, please reach out by using the hashtag TEDxCapeTown across social media and reach out to the team to tell us any ideas how we can reach gender equality in the next 10 years. This has been a fantastic conversation. I have loved every bit of it, and I'm about to go have a candlelit dinner thanks to ESCOM. So we are bang on with time. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Marie. Fabulous. Thank you to everyone.
Fantastic evening.
Thank you so much. Bye now.
Fantastic. Bye bye, everybody.
Bye. Bye.